I'm Adam Harris, the Jaffa Fur Chief Curator of Art here at the museum. First, I'd like to thank our generous sponsors. We had amazing support for this exhibit, for Tom, not surprising at all, Patagonia, the McGee Foundation, Ann Ramsey, in celebration of Elizabeth McCabe. And I just have to say a special note about Liz. She was such a great supporter of photography here at the museum, and it means so much to have the support of her family and her foundation. So thank you. Gloria and Bill Newton, Jade and Dave Walsh, Nancy and Douglas Ayers, the Brooks Foundation, and Heather and Richard Black. Thank you all so much for your support. It would not be possible without your help. I'd like to give all of you. Tom Magnuson, as many of you know, sitting over here, has been a fixture in Jackson Hole since opening his first gallery here in 1978. That was 40 years ago. And this is sort of the 40th anniversary of his time here at Jackson and of being a professional photographer. And so this 40 years is being commemorated with a special set of legacy prints that I think he'll talk about tonight, plus this amazing exhibit, which will tour to at least, I think, 16 venues at current count. And this tour is special, not only because it contains highlights from an amazing life's work, but also because it features two sets of photos touring simultaneously. For those of us like me who create traveling exhibits, let me tell you, it's a rare feat and speaks to the power of these images and to Tom's reputation as one of the world's greatest living nature photographers. So at the same time we're opening our exhibit here, another version is on view at the Durham Museum in Omaha, Nebraska, and it's really fitting that the two opening venues are in Nebraska and Wyoming. Nebraska is where Tom grew up, and Wyoming is where he's made his home. Tom has won too many awards to mention, and he gave me another one right as we were standing here before the program. Some highlights include the 2011 Conservation Photographer of the Year by Nature's Best magazine. He's also named one of the 40 most influential nature photographers by Outdoor Photography. He was honored with Nikon's Legend Behind the Lens recognition. And he's also received the prestigious British Broadcasting Corporation's Wildlife Photographer of the Year Award. His work has been featured in museum shows, including San Diego Natural History Museum, the Natural History Museum in London, the Joslin Art Museum in Omaha, and of course here at the National Museum of Wildlife Art, where we did a big show 10 or 8 years ago of the wonderful panoramic photos that Tom's made, and he just told me that he's the recipient a couple weeks ago of the Sierra Club's Ansel Adams Award for Conservation. And of course, you've probably seen him recently on 60 Minutes earlier this year, and read about or seen about his efforts to subvert the grizzly bear hunt here in Wyoming, which was proposed and then canceled. So I'm sure we'll hear a little bit more about that, I hope. I'm looking forward to hearing more from Tom and seeing a sample of some of his amazing work. So without further ado, please join me in welcoming Thomas C. Magnuson.
This is a special place, as you all came together. It's a little complicated, but I'll do my best. And we also want to thank all the wonderful sponsors, some of our friends, and Liz McKay taught me everything I know. So thank them, Lindsay, and your late mother. She was great. When I first made my started taking photographs and made my first limited edition, it's in 1975 with a can of goose. I never imagined it would be the beginning of a long journey, not only to seven continents, but would also lead to a retrospective here at this museum, which I consider the finest museum of wildlife art in the world. These 40 photographs represent 50 years of my photography, gleaned from approximately 4 million images I've taken in my lifetime. I shoot a lot. Sorry, but that's good. I'm going to have to get used to this, all right. They're not the necessarily best sellers, nor the oldies, but goodies. Some of the best sellers were like a bird on a stick, as we call them today. Like a cardinal on a stick, and it was, you know, sold like hotcakes to little ladies. More images they're more proud of. From that first image to Canada View, so they said, make each image a limited edition. They got the idea of doing limited editions from Owen Grommey, the father of one of my colleagues, when I was working as a cinematographer in Boulder, Colorado, making animal behavior films. Owen was one of America's old master wildlife painters. His son Roy and I would go to his farmhouse in Wisconsin. I loved sitting in Owen's studio watching him paint and just talking with him. I was fascinated by all that went through to make a painting. One day I naively asked him, how long does it take you, Owen, to do one painting? He looked at me with a stub of a cigar in the corner of his mouth and this crooked little smile he always had. He said, boy, all my life. He turned back to his canvas and did a few more strokes of his prairie chicken painting. That was in the early 1970s. I was in my mid-20s. It took me a while to register what he just said. It was one of the most profound phrases and learning experiences I'd ever been given. It soon became obvious. A simple painting involved accumulation of a life in the wild, observing, sketching, remembering the light, the texture, the mood, behavior, the composition. Owen was one of the first and most successful wildlife painters to make limited edition prints from his original oil paintings. He convinced me that I should do the same with my photographs. Owen's advice was good, but easier said than done. Few museums recognized wildlife art as a traditional art form, and wildlife photography was its stepchild. That said, times and attitudes have obviously changed in the last half century, thanks to people like Adam here and National Wildlife Art Museum, who weren't for the encouragement of Owen Grommey, and of course dozens of others since, I wouldn't be here today. I started numbering my limited edition at number 26, wanting to keep the first 25 numbers for family and friends. 4 or 5 years ago, I started contemplating what to do with the first 25 images. Talented assistant, Sue Cedar home here, Andy Bennett, numerous other creative people on my staff started brainstorming. About that time, David Wagner sort of wrote the book on collecting wildlife art, also a museum curator, producer, manager of traveling museum exhibitions into the scene. He asked if I would be interested in doing traveling museum exhibit. And I don't think he had actually done a photography one before. To date, as Adam said, he signed up 16 galleries. The first one in Omaha, the second one here. I couldn't be prouder to be in this, the best in the world. I'm going to go back to my early days when it all got started. I was born and raised, as were my three brothers and my parents in Grand Island, Nebraska. My earliest memories were hunting and fishing with my father. Those bigger catfish are the ones I caught. We never figured out why Mom didn't put a life vest on Billy. I can tell you why. Like most siblings, we were quite different. He always wanted to be a businessman. His goal was to make $1 million by the time he was 30. He was subscribing to the Wall Street Journal when he was 12. He had a trading company called Midwest Trading when he was 13. He ended up living in Hong Kong for 35 years, running an import-export business. Obviously, I chose a different path. We had a one-room schoolhouse in Platte, 23 miles from Grand Island. My dad had hunted there since 1932. He taught me how to make, paint, and set decoys, how to build blinds, and how to call ducks and geese. It was the greatest gift for teaching me patience in natural history. The Platte River had a huge influence on me. It wasn't just the Platte, but the Niobrara and the Loup Rivers, and the sand hills and prairies. We spent many hours and many days hunting, fishing, and just observing. As a freshman in college, I won the world's goose calling championship. I actually won twice. $1,000 savings bonds sticking out of my pocket took me to Europe, where I hitchhiked through numerous countries for the summer. That experience opened my eyes to travel and that there was much to learn about life beyond Nebraska. In 1959, I graduated from Doane College in Nebraska with a degree in biology, then attended graduate school in zoology at the University of Nebraska. Paul Johnsgaard's professor, and considered the world's authority on waterfowl, took me under his wing as a graduate student. I bought my first camera. Paul taught me much about birds, animal behavior, and the basics of all my photography. After 2 years, I moved to the Rocky Mountains west of Boulder, Colorado, and lived in an old mine camp with no electricity or running water, basically being a hippie for 3 years. I eventually got a job and worked for a small film company making animal behavior films for the University of Colorado. The following years, I made films for Nat Geo, the BBC, and PBS on cranes. This is the first print I ever made. And although I loved the storytelling aspect of motion picture making, my attention was driven towards creating or capturing the single moment from still photographs, which I've learned could also tell the story. I was only doing the stills as a hobby, never dreamed of a career in photography. But after selling a few prints at local art fairs in Boulder and here in Jackson, I rented space for a kiosk at Stapleton Airport in Denver. Isn't that a nice gallery there? After coming to Jackson a few times to photograph the Tetons, and this abundant lot of wildlife, meeting people like Marty Murray, considered the grandmother of conservation, and moved here in 1978. I rented a small office space upstairs in Gaslight Alley and opened my first gallery. I just saw Dan Fulton, who I went to college with back in late 1950, just a few minutes ago. And he came to me in about 1980 asking me if I had any work for him. I said, well, maybe for a couple of months, but that would be it. 32 years later, same year, 1978, I photographed this great gray owl, Jim Moran. Thanks to him and all the owl movies out there, I was able to survive this first few years. The image is included in the legacy exhibit. I kept adding to my collection and moved locations to my present gallery in 1983. My first trip to Africa was in 1987. It took a lot of gear in those days to capture the landscape and the wildlife. I was using different formats and still shooting movie film as well. It totally made me crazy. So I'm going to go to actually the collection and tell you a few stories. American Kestrels, 1984. In May, spotted this pair of kestrels in the Lamar Valley of Yellowstone. They were courting and defending their nesting territory among a small grove of aspens. The male on the lower branch, in a matter of an hour, chased off a red-tailed hawk, attacked another male kestrel, caught a mouse for his mate, and then mated with her, then yawned. After all the incredible behavior is over, I realized in my haste to get the photos, I double exposed two rolls of film. My heart sank. Luckily, this frame survived and became my overall favorite photograph of birds. In Pursuit, 1984. I watched this grizzly for several days with Dan Fulton in Denali National Park during early September. She was crazy about digging up and eating Arctic ground squirrels. She was like an excavator that sometimes I see her butt sticking out of a giant hole in the ground. Dan and I, his biggest nightmare was that we would be a squirrel in the pursuit. She never gave up. One day a squirrel sneaked out its back door, burrow, made a run for it across the snowy field. It didn't get unnoticed. This was the last frame on my roll of film. What do you think happened? Out of Darkness, 1985. For years, I would go to Glacier National Park to photograph the gathering of nearly 500 eagles along McDonald Creek in December, who were fishing for kokanee salmon. According to fish biologists, this particular female was well known and had returned to the salmon for a number of years. She was recognizable because she had only one talon. Biologists surmised it had lost the other talent in the muskrat trap. But most of the eagles fished downstream where most of the fish were. She fished alone. Every 2 hours or so, she would return to the river to catch another salmon, having digested the previous meal. Although she was compromised with only having one talon, she had figured it out and was a good as fisherman as any of the other eagles. I estimated the exposure for her white head and tail. Unfortunately, because there was such a difference in exposure, the background went white. I mean, went black, sorry. Wintering Waxwings, 1986. On the way home from photographing the eagles, the temperatures had dropped below 25 below. While driving back to Jackson, I saw flocks of several hundred waxwings cross the highway and followed them to the mountain ash trees, where they would strip the trees of berries in a matter of minutes. Some falling to the ground, drunk, after gorging themselves with fermented fruit. Among the glaciers in 1987. I always loved watching eagles soaring among Alaska's high mountain peaks, but it took years before I caught one on film. Finally, after days of waiting, this eagle soared on the thermals in front of the coastal range above the Chilkat River in southeast Alaska. Catch of the Day, 1988. While working on the Sandhill Crane film in Prince William Sound in southeast Alaska, I had a week between shoots. On my flight from Cordova to Anchorage, I saw an article in an Alaska Airlines magazine about the brown bears at Brooks Falls in Katmai National Park. I'd seen hundreds of published pictures of brown bears from Brooks Falls, but all the potential pictures had been taken. Most were full body portraits or wide angle scenes of the gathering of bears fishing. However, I'd never seen just a head and shoulders portrait of a bear with the salmon entering its mouth and wondered if it were possible. began pre-visualizing the scene. Impulsively, I decided to go see the Bears and call the park headquarters from a payphone in Anchorage Airport and ask about the logistics of going there. The ranger told me the lodge and campsite were full. It was early July and the height of the bear season. When he heard the disappointment in my voice, he said, "Well, there is one site left, but it's only a few yards from a bear trail, and no one wants it." I said, "I'll take it." I caught a taxi to the nearest outdoor store, bought a bunch of Patagonia gear, lots of freeze-dried food. Early the following morning, I caught a float plane to the native village of King Salmon, then on to Brooks Falls. There I set up my camp and hiked a half mile or so to the falls. Along the river, 50 yards from the falls, is a fairly primitive bear viewing platform, 12 foot by 4 foot. Spawning sockeye salmon are picking up a lot of speed to launch themselves over the 8 to 10 foot falls. Getting over the falls was difficult enough, but they would also have to be lucky enough to avoid the jaws of the giant brown bears waiting at the top for the unsuspecting salmon. No matter the challenges, the sockeye were programmed to reach their native spawning grounds miles upriver. I spent a week there, from dawn until dark, waiting for images I had pre-visualized. Some days there were a dozen or more bears, other days there were none. Some were dependent on water temperature and chemistry, or some other factors only known to the salmon. Most days it rained, but I knew for the image I hoped to capture, the decisive moment would be that millisecond between mouth open and mouth closed. Timing, light, exposure, composition, depth of field, shutter speed, and luck would be more critical than usual. I'd seen it happen several times throughout the week, but it happened so fast, I couldn't be sure if I'd reacted quickly enough to capture it. It'd be more than a month before I would see the developed film. This image is not only my most iconic, but my most controversial. Even though it was made in 1988, long before digital, many people still think that it was manipulated. I ask, where would the magic be if it were? Of course, it became the cover of my first coffee table book, published in 1989. Poa Dance, 1989. My first adventure to Canada's Hudson Bay and Manitoba to photograph the polar bears was in 1987. I'd only hoped to get a few good photos of polar bears for a chapter on the Arctic for my first book, Images of Nature. Little did I know, I would become addicted to polar bears and spend the next 10 years photographing them. Fortunately for me, not only did I get to observe and photograph the king of the ice, but I got to meet and become best friends with one of my heroes of the animal planet, Canadian Fred Rumer. He was a writer, photographer, and longtime chronicler of the Inuit from Greenland across North America to the tundra of Siberia. For many years, we'd meet in Churchill, Manitoba, and spent a month or more photographing the great white bears. It was a gray, late November day with a bitter north wind and a ground blizzard. Our kind of day, Fred said, as we watched and photographed the two giant bears play fighting. Agile and graceful dancers, appearing and then disappearing in the near whiteout conditions. So several of our fellow photographers and friends had decided it was too nasty, the light and visibility, too poor to venture out, and stayed in camp. Afterwards, when the bears lay down to cool off, Fred looked at me and only smiled, knowing we had witnessed and photographed something special. Fred was a gentle, quiet, and humble soul. Polar Dance became my favorite image and one of the most loved photographs I've ever made. A few years ago, the International League of Conservation Photographers recognized it as one of the 40 most important nature photographs of all time. More importantly to me, it became the cover of our book, Polar Dance. Fred wrote the text and I did the photographs. We've become only one in many of 27 books and more than 1,000 articles Fred would write over his lifetime. After the Ice Age, 1982, I first saw this grizzly early in the morning feeding on blueberries in the distance, making his way down the glacial moraine. I waited for 6 hours for him to come closer and into the composition that I had visualized with my panoramic camera. I only had a couple of minutes to take a few frames as he passed by. That was the art. Female polar bird or 2-3-year-old male cubs cross the icy landscape of Hudson Bay. They lay down 75 yards away from the tundra bird I was photographing from. One of the cubs used the broken ice as a pillow. This became one of my most popular images, obviously, because it reminds one of ourselves. Into the Wind, 1993. Other than possibly cranes, there's no species that photograph more than bald eagles. The sunrise this morning is coming in, this eagle is coming into land on the coastal sandbar from the shores of Kashmak Bay, Alaska. This image portrays the morning's magic light, the beauty and magnificence of our national bird. Born of the North Wind, 1993. For years, and nearly 80,000 frames later, I always felt that I never captured the true essence of polar bears in their habitat until this image. It shows a lone polar bear with his little Arctic fox companion about to go out on the ice and spend the winter hunting seals. The pink sky and brown lizard all added to how I envisioned the ice bear. Unfortunately, this kind of scene is quickly disappearing due to climate change. Unbeknownst to me, my office assistants entered this image into the BBC Wildlife Photographer of the Year contest. I was pleasantly surprised when he called me months later and told me I had won the competition in 1994. Amboseli Crossing, 1994. One of the main components in photography is, of course, light. This family of elephants crossing the dusty plain in Kenya's Amboseli National Park, their daily journey from a watering hole epitomizes Africa's dry season. The last light of day in the perfect line with tails blowing in unison against the dark sky make this image work. Bath time in Maasai Land. The family of cheetahs just outside of Maasai Mara Park in Kenya. Their mother giving the cubs a bath as they had been feasting on a Thompson's gazelle. With their full stomachs, they will spend the night in the protection of a whistling acacia tree. Gift of Tides, 1995. White ibis, their long bills probing for crustaceans, the tidal flats of Dean Darling National Wildlife Refuge in Florida. Light and Forest, 1998. Banded Park, India is one of the last strongholds of the highly endangered Bengal tigers. It was once the private hunting preserve of Maharaja. Now, fortunately, it's a national park. This tigress was the 18-month-old daughter of Sita, the most famous matriarch of Banthar. In early April 1998, I spent 5 weeks searching for tigers in Banthar's mountainous jungles, some days in small jeeps, other days on elephant back. Midday temperatures often rose to 125 degrees, mornings and evenings were generally cool. At daybreak, one chilly morning, Arma Hoot, the elephant's handler, flagged us down and excitedly said to quickly climb aboard his elephant. We grabbed our cameras and in half dark departed, making our way slowly but surely up the steep mountain slope to the top of the escarpment. There we found Sita's beautiful daughter, recently on her own, draped over a rock, watching for prey in the valley below. Her giant paws showed evidence of a midnight feast. It was one of the most magnificent scenes I'd ever witnessed, but unfortunately it was too dark to photograph. We waited quietly and prayed she wouldn't move until the light came over the mountain. An hour later, the sun broke through the canopy and lit her face in the vegetation beyond. It was just enough light to make a few frames. Moments later, she rose, took a big stretch, turned, and disappeared into the forest. Reflections of Denali, 1998. It was a perfect Indian summer morning in Denali National Park. I had never seen the colors more brilliant in the 20 trips I had visited Denali. The moose rutting season was in full swing. This bull and his small harem were feeding on the willows below the distant hillside beyond the pond. When the bull started heading uphill, I told my colleagues that we should quickly go to the other side of the pond, just in case the bull went along the crest of the alder-covered hill and possibly be silhouetted against Denali in its reflection. The chance of that actually happening was infinitely small. As we reached the far side of the pond, the bull emerged from the alders and stopped in a small clearing at the top of the hill. It was unbelievable. We hurried to set up our tripods and cameras. The panoramic camera was always painfully slow. Just as we were about to click our shutters, the bull lay down. I said something like, "Oh my God, no." And a few other choice words. I tried to rationalize to myself and my friend Chip that with the breeze, the reflection wasn't all that perfect anyway, that we should just wait because the bull would get up sooner or later. We sat and waited for several hours, the breeze died, the pond became smooth as glass with a perfect reflection. The bull's harem stood and began foraging. Then the bull stood up. I quickly shot and cranked off a dozen frames through my camera before he joined his cows. This morning, of course, became one of my most memorable in Denali. More and more, I was using my panoramic camera for animals and their landscape and eventually published The Natural World, a book dedicated to my panoramic images. And it was a show that I had here at the museum 10 years ago. Spirit of the Mountains, 1999. Many of you know and probably were lucky enough to witness the cougar and the three kittens in Miller Butte that year. For years, I'd hoped to even get a glimpse of a mountain lion. People often ask me why I did not have photographs of the mountain lion, since I had images of tigers, lions, leopards, and cheetahs. I knew that 98% of cougar pictures were taken at game farms, basically rent-a-cats, where they were kept in small cages 365 days a year, only taken out to become wildlife models for photographers, filmmakers, and artists. I had no interest in adding to what I considered cruel and inhumane behavior, except that years later, maybe cougars would be a species I would never see or photograph in the wild. Cats on Mantle Butte became an obsession with me. I spent 42 days from dawn until dusk. I finally got this image, which became the cover of a small book called Spirit of the Rockies. Documenting those days led to co-founding the Cougar Fund. Following day, the cougar family left their cave, likely following the spring migration of the elk herd to the High Country. I never saw her again. Dreamcatcher 2000, Kachemak Bay, Alaska. As I've already mentioned, bald eagles became one of my most favorite species. I was challenged on how to make a different picture. I thought an extreme close-up portrait of just the eye and beak might capture the essence of the bald eagle. Redwoods 2000. For a week, I cruised the coastline of Redwoods National Park looking for blooming rhododendrons along redwoods. I had made a handful of decent images of the setting during the week. I was already heading back to Jackson. It was nearly noon, not the best light to photograph. I drove 50 miles, then decided to turn back for one last try with this view. As I got there, coastal fog had blown in from the ocean. The light had become soft and muted, and a beam of light lit up the flowers. I spent the next 2 hours shooting 10 rolls of film. Colors of the Smokies, 2000. As I rounded the bend on the dirt road near Cades Cove and Great Smoky Mountains National Park, the scene blew my mind. There were only a few minutes left before the light would be gone at the end of the day. I rushed to set up my tripod and panoramic camera. I didn't even have time to take a meter reading. I had to guesstimate exposure. Fortunately, I was right on. Shades of Sapphire, 2002. I photographed leopards in the Serengeti many times, but this is by far my favorite image. We'd seen this leopard the day before, hunting in the tall grass near Serenera. The she had disappeared. We went back the following morning to see if we could find her again. There she was, stretched over a huge branch of a sausage tree. She had a tiny cup hidden behind her. She was in deep shadow, so getting the correct exposure was tricky. If I exposed for her, I would lose the sky, which had little detail anyway. The African sky tends to go white, the dust and smoke is always in the air. People always ask me if this is Photoshop. One of my all-time biggest compliments came from the famous painter and friend, Robert Bateman, who said, "This photograph looks like a Bateman." Which I made it. Her eyes were near the same sapphire color as the lichen in the tree. Negative spaces mimics her shape, her tail, paws, and ears. You can see some of Bateman's influence on me and his works in this museum. Rainwalk, 2002, Ndutu Conservation Area, Tanzania. We almost always see drafts in wooded areas eating acacia leaves. It is rare to see them out in the open like this. In the distance, you can see flamingos and zebras, giving scale and perspective to these magnificent animals. The dark clouds of approaching storms show the promise of rain after the long dry spell. Gentle Giant, 2003, Virunga National Park, Rwanda. This was my second trip to Virunga to photograph gorillas. During my first trip a few years earlier, they concentrated on family groups and just excitement of seeing and photographing gorillas. I realized later that I had missed the most impressive of all, the dominant silverbacks. Park rules only allow an hour per day to photograph the gorillas. I decided to spend my hour each of the 3 days we were there, concentrating on these gentle giants. I had waited 45 minutes for this one to wake up, and I almost given up. My time was running out, and I saw a movement, his great face staring at me through the leaves. His look has changed my life forever. Tapish Mushi, 2003. Approximately every 10 years, during late April, the Tehachapi Mountains of Central California are ablaze with this kaleidoscope of wildflowers, predominantly California poppies and lupin. 2003, I got word that the flowers were exceptional. I loaded up my car and drove to California, not wanting to miss the spectacle. The second night I was there, the wet snow fell in the mountains. I was afraid that the flowers would freeze, but instead it spurred them to bloom even more. High noon on the Oxbow Bend, 2003. My favorite place in the lower 48 is the Teton Park at the Oxbow Bend. Not only is it incredibly scenic, it also has one of the highest concentrations of species in the greater Yellowstone. This particular morning, I've been teaching a photographic workshop from sunrise until mid-morning. When we were all about to leave to head back to town, I turned back and took one last glance at the mountains. It was one of the very best seasons for fall color. The aspens were at full peak, and the water at the Oxbow was dead calm under reflecting the Tetons, colored beautifully. I'd already packed up my tripod and cameras, who was reluctant to leave. I asked the students if they wanted to stay longer, and they politely said, "You're ready to go get breakfast." I took my tripod and panel camera out of the car and went back to the perch I had along the shore. By noon, I fell asleep in the warm sun. I woke to the sound of wings overhead and saw an eagle chasing an osprey with a fish in its talons. I quickly changed shutter speed to stop the motion of the flying birds and reframe the scene. Pressured by the eagle, the osprey dropped the trap, plunged into the water, and as the eagle banked to try and steal the osprey's fish, I clicked the shutter. The fish sank, and neither bird got the prize. I didn't know if I'd captured the scene for a couple of weeks until after the film was processed. Guardian of Night Inlet, 2005. Today, I was on a trip to the Great Bear Rainforest in British Columbia. I was there to photograph brown and black bears. On the first day, we went out in a small fishing boat to survey the bay. When I saw this rock outcropping, the fog and mountains in the background, I asked my guide, Jamie, if he could arrange to have a black bear on the front for one. week, we cruised the shoreline looking for bears, but didn't have much luck. Final day was pouring rain. We had to catch our float line out that afternoon. There wasn't much enthusiasm to go out in the rain again, but it was our last few hours from the van. As we rounded the van and this outcropping came into view, we saw this large black bear eating mussels that were exposed at low tide. We approached the shore slowly, quietly in the boat. I just started using my first digital camera. I was madly shooting the scene with both my film and digital camera. My assistant Sue could barely keep up changing the film. The bear went around to the back side of the point. We moved the boat to that side in hopes that he would go up on top of the rocks. We were too late, and he'd already headed back to where he was. All we could see was his backside. We quickly moved back to where we started. The bear was unable to get down the slippery kelp and turned back, paused on top of the rock, looked over his domain as a shot many frames as possible. It was an incredible scene that had pre-visualized. We would have never guessed it would ever happen. On the way back to the lodge, Jamie turned to me and said, "Tom, in my 7 years of guiding here, I've never seen a bear on that point." We both laughed. This became my first digital image. Morning shower, 2006. At 5 o'clock a.m., we pulled our Zodiac onto the beach at St. Andrews Bay on South Georgia Island. The king penguins were coming out of the ocean after feeding. As they came out of the water, they would shake off. I had knelt down to get a better angle. I noticed the spray backlit the rising sun. My sister Sue got antsy and wanted to move on down the shore to another scene. I kept shooting. It was a couple months later when Sue was editing the images from the trip. She called me and said, "Now I know why you stayed in that spot so long." The image went on to win the Best Nature Image of the Year by American Photo Magazine in 2007. Druid's Frosty Morning Passage in 2008. It was mid-January and 20-something below zero when we saw the Druid pack of wolves in Yellowstone. Druids were the most famous pack because they were the original wolves that were reintroduced in 1995. The numbers in the pack fluctuated widely. In 2008, there were 15 animals in the pack. We followed them up and down the Lamar Valley as they hunted. The day before, we had last seen them at sunset in Round Prairie, the east end of Lamar Valley. This morning, we found them headed back west. We were paralleling them along the highway. We saw these cottonwood trees covered with hoarfrost from the steam rising from Soda View Creek. We drove ahead a mile so I could set up my camera. The sun was just coming over the top of the ridge, the background still in deep blue shadow. I framed the image for the trees and long line of wolves. Due to mange and interspecies conflict, the Druid pack was wiped out in 2010. Windswept, 2008. That same winter, not far from where the wolves were photographed, a bachelor herd of a half dozen bison were searching for long grasses beneath 18 inches of snow. Bison cleared the snow away by swinging their massive heads back and forth and covering the grasses. This particular day, the winds were fierce, and most of the roads in the area were closed from ground blizzards. The wild weather did not faze these hardy animals. The coast made for this climate. Spring process, 2010. Western tanagers migrated to that Jackson Valley every spring. Their mating plumage is enhanced by the contrast of the early spring green leaves. I spent a week photographing these gorgeous birds using a very shallow depth of field. Of the background. Snake River Crossing, 2010. For many years, I tried to capture herds about crossing the Snake River at sunrise. In 2010, I dedicated 2 weeks in hopes of capturing an image like this. As the sun came over the mountains and highlighted the mist rising off the river, a bull elk and his harem of a dozen cows began crossing the river. As another bull bugled in the distance, this bull could not resist. Briefly paused to answer the other bull's challenge. year, 2010. Another morning that same fall, we walked down to a different vantage point where the Snake River bends in hopes to find an elk herd crossing the river in front of Mount Moran. It was barely light. As we approached the river, we saw something dark on the gravel bar on the opposite shore. With binoculars, we saw that it was a grizzly pulling a freshly killed elk up the river. It was a serendipitous moment. We didn't expect to find it there, only elk. For the next 5 days, we went out to observe the bear, and we recognized his 399, feet under kill. It was one of the years 399 didn't have cups. She dragged the elk's carcass from the river to the edge of the woods, then buried it, lay on top of it, and fiercely protected it from any scavengers, including coyotes, bald eagles, ravens, and magpies. On the fourth morning, shortly after we arrived, she was crossing the river, going back to her prize. Miraculously, at the same time, the sun kissed the top of Mount Moran. This image became the cover of a coffee table book, Last Great Wild Places. Mountain Outlaw, 2014. When the roads first opened in Yellowstone each spring, it's the best time to go looking for bears. This particular spring was no exception. For years, bears were discovered crossing Yellowstone River fall through the ice. The bears would discover them. They got caught up in the hardy rapids. This particular year, there were five bears fighting over and taking turns feasting on a carcass. One of the bears was a female, apparently an estrus. She swam the river across the highway behind us. Soon after, several other bears followed her trail and they squabbled in the woods. This big old bear with battle scars emerged from the forest, obviously the victor. He was trying to see where the female had gone, which was not far from the opposite side of my vehicle. Standing near my car door, I had to abandon a tripod and camera with my 1200mm lens as he approached. He sauntered by, crossed the highway, went on to court the female, eventually made it with her. Eyes of the Grizzly, 2011. Blondie, as she is affectionately called, because of her golden guard hairs, is my favorite grizzly next to 399. She was approximately 3 years old when this photograph was made near Pelican Creek at Grand Teton Park. For a number of years, like clockwork, Blondie would show up in the same meadows and the biscuit root were blooming. She generally stayed for a few weeks and then disappeared into the high country. No one knew where she went, but all anticipated her return in the spring. The most recent photograph is at Pelican Creek, and Todd Wilkins tells the story of her 399 and the issues facing grizzly in Yellowstone. She's now 22 years old, has had 17 descents, is not only my favorite bear, but the most famous bear in the world. Winter Beauty, 2016. Another cat I had never photographed in a while previously was a bobcat. Not too many years ago, a few bobcats had learned to hunt ducks, geese, swans along the Madison River in Yellowstone. Like many cats, bobcats are not fond of getting wet. But apparently, the reward was worth the discomfort. We observed this cat for 2 days along the river. He would slink along the shoreline, looking for a good place to hide so as to ambush unsuspecting ducks and geese, and once in a while, even a swan. We saw him make several attempts, leaping into the frigid water, but without success. I'd gone ahead a mile or so as he was making his way along the Madison. I got down low at the edge of some cattails and hid, which I'd learned from him, so I wouldn't be seen. When he heard my camera shutter click, he froze. He seemed surprised, as if I had outwitted him with his own tricks. Cranes of the Gray Wind, 2011. The only trip I make annually is to go back to my roots in the Platte River in Nebraska. I stay at the same hunting cabin I grew up in. I took my first photographs of flying ducks, geese, and cranes. Every March, a 500,000 sandhill cranes migrate through Nebraska, mostly coming from Mexico and Texas, headed to the nesting grounds in the far north. We'll spend a month here along the river, roosting at night and feeding the fallow cornfields during the day. This is truly one of the most incredible bird spectacles in the natural world. The cacophony The range of calls were always with me. I've been blessed to have grown up among Cranes, and blessed a second time to be here at Jackson. Thank you very much. Anybody else?
Yes.
Who that?
When you were shooting film, what was your favorite film to use? What kind of film?
Okay, when I was shooting film, the question is, what was my favorite film? Well, whatever was available at the time, number one. Kodachrome 25 was the first film I used, then 64, and then Ektachrome 64, and then sort of after that, Fujichrome Galvia 50, and Fujichrome 100, and that pretty much carried me through until I shot digital, which I do now. So I think speaking out, number one, writing letters, you write letters to whoever might be involved. We wrote a lot of letters to the governor about the grizzly bears, did no good. We wrote a lot of letters to the legislature, did no good. I mean, basically, I think it depends on what the political climate is and who's in office. It will make a difference. And a lot of times letters do make a difference. I think we had 650,000 letters written. A lot of petitions, I mean, just basically public comment. You know, people making public comments, standing up for what you believe in, makes a difference. As far as what organizations there are many, my favorite is, besides the Cougar Fund, which I helped start, obviously, But internationally, worldwide, would be Jane Goodall Institute. I think she's a dear friend of mine. I met her actually here. I introduced her 20 years ago. We see a dear friend. She called me Butler for your 18th year. See the cranes also. When I say the cranes are special, she's been here 18 years, so you can be sure you're pretty special. But I think she's doing the greatest work through Roots and Shoots program, which is mostly for young people through high school, to educate kids, to protect, you know, first of all, their own village or town or city, their pets. It might start with pets and then other animals and beyond country and that. And that program, I think, is the most, when we educate kids and change kids' ideas. Most of us are too old to go out to teach new tricks necessarily. I think the young people will be our, you know, our survival, hopefully. But, you know, there's a lot of places. I hate to say, you know, you've got Earth Justice, who's a big player in the grizzly bear issue, was huge. Sierra Club, trying to think of ones that you don't get lost in. But anyway, there's quite a few out there. Pick anyone, just speak out.
What's the farthest place you've ever traveled to get a picture?
One more time?
What's the farthest place you've ever traveled to get a picture?
The furthest place I've ever traveled to get a picture would be Antarctica. In South Georgia, where that penguin picture was taken, is where Sue and I are going next week, after a couple weeks. That would be my fifth trip to Antarctica. Basically, South Georgia is an island off of Antarctica. So that would be, well, that's the other end of the world, so that's about as far as I could go.
Shout.
Okay, Susan.
Two-part question. Over the decades being around all these animals, you've come to understand animals, these fellow creatures we live with. I wish you could speak to your sense of who these other creatures are, who these animals are. And the second part of the question is, what do you think our relationship to them ought to be?
Did everybody hear that question?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So, what I learned by growing up on the planet to begin with and watching animals and enjoying them and hunting them, we ate everything we shot. So it was a part of our, you know, our table fare every year, and it's important to us. We didn't have all that much money. And I feel the same way about hunting today. If one wants to go out and shoot an elk or a deer or whatever, put it on the table, it's fine. You know, it's a sporting thing, hopefully, not necessarily in Teton Park. But watching animals over my lifetime, I've learned that they are indeed a lot closer to us than I ever imagined when I was a kid. You know, they are intelligent, they're sentient, emotional, they show joy, they show fear, they show pain. We can see that in their dogs. I mean, you don't have to go very far. You look at your dog in the Labrador home, he wasn't very happy that I left. He was all excited to go. I mean, it's sort of 101. But if you take a bear's intelligence compared to a Labrador's intelligence, it's probably greater. You take an elephant's intelligence compared to a bear's intelligence, it's probably far greater. Then you get to the primates, like chimpanzees and gorillas and things. You know, it's, I don't know how to compare elephants and chimpanzees, but it's pretty hot. So we should be treating them as we would treat our own. We should not be killing bears. You know, because they're such special creatures. And cougars, same one. They have intelligence, joy, all the feelings that we have. And to kill them for fun, which is what we're doing, which is what the game of fish says we're doing, because I've asked Dan Thompson, the carnivore biologist, I said, why are we killing cougars and bears, the orphan offspring, more often than not? And he said, for recreation. because we are mandated to provide recreation for our constituents, the hunters. Now that, to me, is a pretty lousy excuse to kill a sentient being. It has offspring who will oftentimes be orphaned, and oftentimes will die a slow, miserable death without its mother. Thank you so much.